Hi guys, welcome back to my channel. Today we're going to be chatting about the things that first time buyers need to know about buying their first home, the hidden costs behind buying your first home, and things that you need to take into consideration before you do buy your first home. The caveat to this is that we are still in our process of buying our first home. It's been a long process, one that I've documented here on my channel. I've also done a full video on how to buy a home, so the process of buying a house in the UK, this is. So if you want to watch that one after this, I'll link it in the description bar and at the end of this video. But this one is going to be more about the hidden costs and what to consider and what to save for. It's not just a deposit that you're going to need to save for. With the government guaranteeing the 95% mortgages now, I feel like there's going to be a huge surge of people that didn't have the opportunity to buy until now, that weren't able to get the deposit together until now. And this is probably going to be something that I certainly would have loved to have been able to watch when I was first looking, because we've learned so much along the way and there is just so much information that you probably aren't aware of if you're new to this, especially if you kind of weren't planning on buying a house anytime soon because you couldn't get the deposit together, but suddenly now with the government guaranteeing them until December 2022 at 95%, maybe you're thinking this is your time. So this video is hopefully going to be really helpful. If it is helpful to you, please do give it a like because it will help other people find it, and obviously it just helps me guide me into what kind of videos you want to see here on my channel. If you're new here, I'm Lara. We have been trying to save and try to buy for our first home for quite a while now, and we are in a position to do so. However, the market at the moment is just absolutely wild, and I've done videos on my thoughts about it. This isn't going to be about that today. If you want to see my kind of raw and honest thoughts about the situation at the moment and stamp duty holiday and the mortgages, you can head over to my recent video. In fact, that will be at the end of this video as well. This is more going to be a practical guide for anyone looking to buy a house. So congratulations if you are one of those people. It's a very exciting time. It can be a very, very stressful time indeed. So obviously the fun part of house hunting is actually looking for properties, going to see them, finding out what you can afford. And the government are actually doing this a little bit different because, you know, the worry would be in 2008, we went through housing crisis and housing crash, and none of the loans that were given back then at 110%, 105%, the credit history wasn't looked into. They weren't as harshly monitored as this round is going to be. So you will still need to do all of the affordability checks that you would do for an 85% mortgage as you would do for this 95% mortgage. And this basically means that you just need to find 5% of the deposit. So there are similar schemes out there from the government with the Help to Buy. The main difference is, well, this one is actually available to all buyers, so not just first-time buyers. So that means if you maybe you had a property with an ex-partner or an ex-friend or anything like that, and then you sold it and then you wanted to buy again but you would then not be considered a first-time buyer, this means that you can still get this scheme as a 95% mortgage, which will help. And it also is available on pre-existing homes, so it's not just first-time homes, which is great because so many, you know, builders, they've always been able to get people in to buy their homes because it's only available to new builds. This is going to open it up. So let's just chat quickly about what makes a first-time buyer, in case you're not quite sure. So that is basically anyone that has never owned a house before, whether it's with somebody else, whether it's inherited, it's never owned any land before or anything like that. So as long as you have not owned before or with a partner, then you could be considered a first-time buyer. And what are the benefits of being a first-time buyer? Well, the main advantage was that you would not pay stamp duty. Stamp duty, land tax, is tax that the government charge us to buy a house. I mean, you know, because it's not expensive enough as it is. So we are charged a land tax to buy the house, and first-time buyers weren't actually charged that up until last year when the government tried to stimulate the market again and get house prices going. Again, I'm not going to go into detail here because I did it in my recent vlog, at home vlog. This is basically waived up to £300,000 for first-time buyers. At the moment, all buyers, so whether you've already owned a house, whether you're on a buy-to-let investor, you won't be charged the stamp duty tax. At the moment, difficult because that means that first-time buyers don't have that to their advantage. However, there is still an advantage of being a first-time buyer, and that you are much more preferable for the most part to sellers. So it does keep you in a good position. This means that if you are up against five other buyers when you have found a house, you could maybe have your offer accepted. And I've known friends that have had they've actually accepted an offer of a lower offer because the person is a first-time buyer. The benefit to the seller because of this, it means you don't have any delays in your chain. You literally have one person or a couple wanting to buy a house. So that means that, you know, if someone is buying a house, but they have to sell their house, and then there's someone's buying that house, there's a chain, and this chain can cause delays, conveyancy, you have to wait for surveys to come back. So there's lots of little links in this chain. Whereas if you're a first time buyer, the advantage is that your chain should be stress free. You aren't selling anything, you're just buying this house. So you should be nice and easy to deal with, and therefore much more beneficial to the seller. They may have a house that they want to buy that they don't want to miss out on. So they might think, right, we'll go with a first time buyer. That's a quicker chain that end. And so I'm not actually waiting on anyone else to complete my purchase of the next home. So the government actually will say they've extended it just now in the recent budget. I also did a whole video on what the budget means for first time buyers. Try and link it in the description bar for you. This scheme, which would save second, third time buyers up to £15,000 on a house of the £500 threshold cap, there's a lot of money to be saved. So obviously it's helped so many people move that might not have thought about moving. It's due to end in the end of September if the government don't extend it again. Okay, so into the cost. So what you need to be really aware of and really factor into your budget is that buying a house isn't just the cost of the deposit. There are so many more costs associated with buying a house. So you need to be really aware of your affordability. So at the moment, you may well be able to afford that mortgage. You know, the lenders are going to want to give you the biggest loan that you can actually afford to pay back. They won't allow you to take out more than you can't afford. However, the big thing here is to check that once rates change and they're at an all-time low at the moment, you may well be faced with an extra £800, £500 a month to find to pay off that mortgage. So the 95% mortgages are actually fixed at five years. And even if you're not going for the 95% mortgage, I do suggest that you go for a longer term as possible, because that will then hopefully give you as much more equity in the property once you come to remortgage and get a different rate. If it's lower, then your overall cost is going to be lower because you would have had a bit more equity in your property and you won't need as big a mortgage. The key thing here is that the bigger your deposit, the better your rates are going to be. You're going to be more beneficial to, if you can, wait. Don't rush ahead, because you're allowed to do this. Is around for almost 2 years, till the end of December 2022. And it's just not to rush into this because suddenly you're allowed to buy a house. So make sure that you can afford it if the rates change. Make sure if you can save as much more as possible, if you can get to 10%, then you are in a much better position. So a mortgage is basically like a big loan, like the biggest loan you'll probably ever have in your whole life. And it is, you can get an interest only or a repayment mortgage. So you'll always pay the interest on your mortgage, and that's what the rate is that you pay. But it's whether you pay just interest off and then a balloon payment at the end, or if you pay off part of actually what your house is worth in the payments. And the term is typically over 20 to 30 years, depending on your age and how much interest you want to pay back. So obviously the less amount of time you're paying it back, the less amount you'll be paying back overall. And you've got to think, over the time of your mortgage, you know, if you have it for 10 years less, if you can repay in a lot, you know, in the parameters of what you're allowed to overpay, then the actual, you know, like I talk about compound interest over on my investing videos, it's incredible when it works in your favor. But equally, if you're paying off interest from a mortgage, it's actually money that you're just giving, that you're losing basically, that you're having taken away because of the interest. So the least amount of time and the most amount of deposit is the optimum mortgage that you want to get, but make sure you're fixing for 5 years, because these rates will not be around forever. I think the highest was about 17% in the 80s maybe. So yeah, I mean, imagine it going up like that. So just make sure you are affordable if things do change in the future. So there have been some other schemes, and did I ever do a help to buy video? I can't remember. I did a help closing or a help to buy ISA, because that was a massive waste of time. They still do the LISA, so that's a lifetime ISA. There's the help to buy equity loan, which is a government loan of 20% of the house price, meaning that you need to find 5% yourself. So this is similar, but it has different constraints that this new scheme doesn't come with. And basically you're getting a loan from the government for 20%, and then you're only coming up with 5%. So again, it helps people get on the housing ladder, it helps first time buyers. And there is also shared ownership, which is whereby you own a percentage and then you rent some of it from a local housing authority as well. So there are government schemes. The idea is to help people get onto the ladder. You know, I'll keep my own personal opinions on the whole thing to myself, because This is just hopefully a factual video that help you guys if you're also looking to get a mortgage. So there are lots of different schemes, and there have been over the years, this being the most recent. So let me know in the comments, guys, are you now thinking that you might be able to own a house? You might be able to buy a house. It's very exciting. Obviously it can get very stressful, and more so when you're trying to sell a house and buy another house. But yeah, let me know, get involved in the comments. Let me know what you think of the new scheme. So next up, we're going to talk about other additional costs. So you've got your deposit, which is typically 5%, say at the moment, up to, you know, 15% if you can find it, would be amazing. A lot of money. And I should mention that the 5% mortgage is up to £600,000. So that should encapsulate the London market as well. The problem is the loan to value. So the LTV, basically the affordability of getting a loan for the mortgage is based on your average salary and a multiplication of that, differing if you're buying with a partner or another person. So it still means that a lot of people, despite then only needing 5% deposit, their affordability, so if you earn £25,000 a year and you get 4 times your salary or 3.5 times your salary, you're still not anywhere near the amount of money that you will need to buy a property. So it, in my opinion, isn't really the ideal situation to help first-time buyers get on the market, unless obviously you are in an area where the house prices aren't crazy, which at the moment is probably Mars. Hopefully it will help you if you're trying to get onto the market. So the next cost that you need to think about is conveyancy and surveys and solicitor fees. So consider around £2,000 is what you're going to need for those. So the solicitor you will instruct when you first buy a house, and they will do things like drawing up contracts. They will do safe exchange of deposit and of monies. They will deal with the land registry, make sure there's no issues, organise a survey. So all of these things are in the solicitor's job, and as I said, about £2,000 what you should expect to pay here. So some new build homes will have packages where they'll pay your stamp duty, doesn't really mean much anymore. They will pay your legal fees, which is your solicitors, they will pay, you know, they put a free kitchen in for you, upgrade, that sort of thing. But if you're obviously buying a second pre-existing home, then you do need to factor that into your budget. So within that, the surveys, I mean, they could be up to £500. They are just going to check over the house. It depends on the type of survey you go for. A home buyer survey, I think, is the most basic one. You could go up higher and higher and actually get really in-depth things checked out. So, you know, if your home's older, maybe you want to do that. If it's on a bit of a dodgy land and you want to make sure that, you know, everything belongs to you, or that, you know, you've had historic issues before, but they should pick this up and advise you here. So moving costs also need to be in your budget, and I'm torn with this one because obviously you could get it for free if you do all the hard work yourself and the heavy lifting. And as much as that is like budget saving, I have heard some horror stories of people, and the majority of them say, I wish we'd paid someone to do this for us. So you can get companies, they will come in and they will box everything up, they will label it, they will take it to your new home, they will unpack it for you, and they will do the job for you. So for me, that does sound amazing, but obviously you then need to factor in thousands of pounds to do that as well. So it's up to you and what you find. You may not be, you know, able to do it, so you definitely need to get help. But ask neighbours, ask friends, ask family if they can. At the moment, not sure of what the rules are, but obviously this video will be in the ether once lockdown has finally ended. So yeah, lots of this will change. So the 95% mortgage won't be applicable after December 2022. So I'll need to make another video for then. So the next one is things like you need to consider your council tax, and these are done in brands and brackets. You need to consider home insurance and look at mortgage insurance as well. So if anything happens to you, shop around for this, because if you buy it from the broker, you may be charged more for using them. So just shop around for these things. And obviously you're gonna have to include utilities, food, which is like the biggest expense every month after rent and mortgage. And I've done loads of videos on how to save money on your groceries. I've done heaps, I don't know what that word was. I've done heaps of videos on how to save for your mortgage as well, so, or for your deposit, how to pinch pennies here and there and actually save up for something big like this. So if you are new to my channel, there is a ton of resources here. I think about 500 videos, and a lot of them recently have been about money saving, and how to save for a deposit and house buying as well. So if you're interested in our journey, I've been sharing videos of us, you know, going through the process, the ups and the downs. The main key thing that I've learned over this last year is that the right house is out there for everybody, and what is for you won't pass you. I think that's really important. We lost a house that we reserved in December 2019, and thank goodness we did, because I can't even, like, it would have just been the wrong house for us. It was a rush decision because the builder was putting on pressure. It was like the last house, you know, you'll do your discount, blah, blah, blah. And yeah, we're pleased we didn't get it, but we are still in the position of waiting to buy somewhere. But the right house is waiting for us. So if it does fall apart, don't stress, you know, just try and zoom out a bit and look at it from the bigger perspective and think, well, this isn't for you. This house is not for you, because what is won't pass you. It can be very stressful, but try just to keep calm and trust the process. So I hope this video is helpful. I'm just looking at my notes. I think I've finished everything here that I wanted to talk to you about, but let me know in the comments if you want any other videos around home buying and first time buyer stuff. I can't wait to start doing my new vlogs of buying, like our house buying series. I put them on hold because we're in lockdown, and you know, as much as you're allowed to go and look for houses at the moment, obviously, yeah. So those will be back once we're back out of lockdown and we can feel a bit more comfortable about going to view properties and sharing it with you guys. Thank you guys so much for watching. I hope this video was helpful. Head over to my blog, Laura Joanna Jarvis, for a more of a detailed document if you want to have it in writing. And I will see you guys so soon. Thanks for watching. Bye!